and Matteo Renzi, Prime Minister of Italy.
Your Excellency, special guests, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us on this beautiful afternoon at Georgetown, and welcome to Georgetown University. Today, we are honored to have His Excellency Matteo Renzi, Prime Minister of Italy, here on the hilltop. Prime Minister Renzi is a groundbreaking leader, an international symbol for reform, progress, and egalitarian opportunity. Even before becoming Italy's youngest prime minister in February 2014 at the age of 39, Prime Minister Renzi made tremendous strides as a political leader. From June 2004 through June 2009, he served as president of Florence province, making him the youngest to serve in this capacity. Following his time as president, he became mayor of Florence, and in his 5 years as mayor, he decreased the number of city councilors. He established hundreds of free Wi-Fi sites throughout the city. He reduced the waiting lists for kindergarten grade level and increased funding for the province's welfare programs and academic institutions. His progressive legacy doesn't stop there. In 2010, he proposed to reform the very party he represented, insisting that Italy direly needed change after its prolonged period of economic bleakness. Since taking his current office, Renzi has revitalized the economy despite skepticism and pushback about his approach, and the reality of repairing the nation's finances. He recently unveiled the annual fiscal plan that projects to alleviate Italy's acquired debt after 3 years of a deep recession. His platform as prime minister has also focused on issues of labor reform and constitutional amendment. He is breaking ground in his communication style, both within and outside his constituency. He is an avid Twitter user with over 1.8 followers. You should follow him. And outside of wearing his political hat, he is an enthusiastic football fan, a devoted watcher of Netflix series House of Cards. His connection as Georgetown is strong. He was here 4 or 5 years ago. And his dedication and his vow to bounce back in times of conflict and crisis is inspirational and reflective of the spirit we think we aspire to as well. I welcome you to Georgetown.
Mr. Provost, faculty students, dear friends of Georgetown University, your excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, amiche ed amici italiani, thank you so much for this warm welcome. I'm really honored to be here. I visited Georgetown University 4 years ago as mayor of Florence, exactly in this very gorgeous place. And today, for me, it's particular an honor to start my journey in the United States and in the capital of the world, Washington, D.C., from a university, from your university. Because I think in this moment of the world, universities are more than a simple symbol. It's really a great challenge to discuss about the relation between universities and politics today. If you think universitas in Latin expression indicates spreading knowledge and uniting students, we can risk very interesting link between the expression e pluribus unum. Because really, universitas, in Latin expression, university today, are the earth of the knowledge, the earth of the future. I know. In my country, universities is first of all the place of identity and the place in which the custodian of wisdom and of identity live every day. But I prefer image university not only as custodian of this identity, but a laboratory for the ideas of the future. Culture, research, study, innovation, the written word, think about it. The product of this labor of the mind is the foundation of our values today. And if you think about the last terrible tragedies around the world, if you think about Garissa, Kenya, if you think about a little school in Peshawar, Pakistan, if you think about the Museum of Bardo in Tunisia, you can imagine exactly that. The place of culture are the targets for the terrorists. Why? Because is exactly that the goal and the targets of terrorists, the ideals and the ideas of the future. For this reason, let me first pay respect for this university and for the prestigious of Georgetown, a place in which a lot of students share an idea of the future. And when I was mayor, for me, the most important thing for my city, Florence, obviously, are not only the museum and the cultural heritage, but also the presence of American universities most important around Europe. The number of American universities in my city, in Florence, are the most important number around my continent. And this is a symbol of opening mind and opening perspective for the future. Obviously, culture is key at the time on the fight against terror. If you think terrorists want us to die, and if they can't, they want us to live in fear and in the obscurity. My friends of Georgetown Universities, our role is crucial and very important because you can show around the world the absolute importance of culture as a possibility to live not against terror, but with idea and effort of our values. This is the reason for which now we think university, education, study, culture, the most powerful ways for us to say no to terror. We can say no, we must say no. And I think if this is the challenge, for Italy, there is a very important role around the world. If really we think now is the time to fight against terrorists and terrorism with the ideas of culture, my job is a very incredible job because I am the prime minister, the leader of the government in one of the most beautiful and important country for the culture around the world. But it's also a terrific job if you think we can ensure the future to a country whose past is so exciting that just saying the word future seems very hard. But this job is also fun because I want to tell you that the future is more interesting than the past. Also in Italy, even in Italy. So, let me pay a last tribute to this university and the particular experience, the Jesuit experience. I remember Teilhard de Chardin, who said that the future will always end up happening. This is the point of my speech. I believe the future in Italy is more interesting than the past. Oh, I know, eh? I know very well the incredible past of my country. Italy is rich with beauty, art, food. I don't speak about soccer because exactly in this moment Fiorentina lost with Dynamo Kiev, so I don't speak about soccer. The smile is not very elegant. My situation in the heart is terrible after this result. So we know the past in Italy is beautiful. BuzzFeed gave 39 reasons last week not to visit Italy. Dolomiti, Val d'Orcia, wine, Sardinia Sea, and we can continue. We have a unique art heritage, and more than half the UNESCO Global Heritage are in our country. Italy is a land of science, of experiment, of innovation. Of course, you might think they used to have Leonardo da Vinci, now there is Matteo Renzi. This is a little problem for the decline, symbol of decline of Italy. But this is, for me, very important. The real challenge for my country is stop to look only in the past and try to turn in a different way. Italy, for the moment, in the last 20 years, in particularly in the last 20 years, Italy seems a sleeping beauty. Politics, government, what you called in Washington DC Beltway, got stuck. The world changed around us, and for a long time, Italy were unable to reform. Now it's the time in which we can use this expression. Italy is back. And if the world of globalization asks for a different ideas of culture, values, education, Italy is exactly the place in which a lot of things could change, must change. For this reason, education is at the center of our agenda. Innovation, not only in technology, in the space, in the investment of the future, but also lifestyle. Design means culture plus engineering. Food, high-end engineering. Museums, we decide a little thing. For the first time, the decision about the manager of museum in Italy depend not from the politicians, but from a race, international race. We publish the possibility to become director of museum in Italy in The Economist. And we ask everyone around the world to run for this service, a real incredible change for Italian mind. For 20 years, Italy has feared globalization. We need to defend for 20 years our 0.2 of the world surface. And now it's the time in which we open our mind and our goal, but also our dreams. And we ask to 800 million middle-class consumers, ask for beauty, quality. We try to present them an idea of Italy, very different, multicultural, dynamic, flexible, and open to challenging in the future. For this reason, we invest a lot of our time in a process of reforms, institutional reform. For the students of This is a symbol of future. Don't worry. It's it's absolutely in my framework, perfect. Electoral law. In Italy, usually there is a large coalition, and it's very difficult to image who is the winner in the election. In every part of the world, you know who is the winner. In Italian politics, this is very difficult because there is not a clear message, okay, this is the winner. There is a long debate after the election to understand who is the winner. You smile, I cry, this is the problem. But before I cry, I decide to change. And the new electoral law now is a reality. Exactly in the next weeks, we will approve the last vote in the Chamber of Deputies. Reforming Constitution, second reform. Senate reform, faster legislation. Three, modernizing and cutting costs of the public administration. I present to my project of reform of public administration to my colleagues and friends as, I'm sorry for the advertising, exactly as an iPhone. Because the Italian public administration is very difficult. I propose a very simple model, a model in which everybody could understand exactly an icon of an app of iPhone. What is the relation? What is the relation with the public service of healthcare? The public relation with the fiscal system? A very simple model in which we can have with the digitalization and innovation a simple model of relation and government. Four, a more simple, a more fair and simple tax system. Also because the goal to create a simple tax system in Italy, it's absolutely a priority. Woody Allen said, we must pay taxes with a smile. I tried, but they still asked for my money, not for the smile. So we must absolutely reduce the taxation in Italy, because pay the tax with a smile is not the way. But we must also give a very clear possibility to discuss with the public administration. Five, labor market reform to increase flexibility and open up opportunities for those who have less. This is called Jobs Act. I'm sorry, is copyright is from American administration. I copy. But I think also copy is a form of art in Italy. A faster, more certain justice system. A seven, very important, the fight against corruption with a new, very dynamic and powerful organization in this in our system called ANAC. With the leadership of Raffaele Cantone, a judge who fought against the Camorra and mafia in Campania. The work that we have done on reforms is closely connected to our political role in European Union. We can change the politics in European Union, and we started after the last election, 2014. I'm very happy for the result of European election because if I ask you, what is the first party in Europe? Everyone could give an answer, the party of Angela Merkel. CDU, the German party of right. It's correct because she received, Angela is my friend, received 10.6 million of votes. But the Italian Democrat Party, our party, received 11.2 million. So just one time I underline this very important result. Jokes apart, also if this is not a joke, but jokes apart, we represent a strong, progressive, and reform-oriented European mainstream against populism, but against also the theory of austerity. Because if you think the economy in United States and in Europe in 2008, you can imagine today American economy, thanks to leadership of President Obama, reduce the level of unemployment and increase the level of GDP. European economy from 2008 to 2014 reduce the GDP and increase the level of unemployment. Italy had a lot of problems with this theory. The first responsibility is Italian. Because if we continue to live in the past, if we don't accept the challenge of the future, if we don't try to realize reforms, it's normal to risk the depression. So the first responsible for the crisis in Italy is not Europe, is Italian politicians. But at the same time, when we decide to start with very ambitious program or reforms, we know the next challenge is create a different approach in European institutions. We start with the first results, investment plan of Jean-Claude Juncker, the communication of flexibility by Commission, and third, the QE, quantitative easing realized by European Central Bank in this moment exactly because the climate in the discussion in Europe is changing. But this is also the first time. So there is no way back from reforms in Italy. This is a very clear message. There is no way back from reforms in Italy, but at the same time, we can imagine a reform not only about institutional, but about education, about values, about smart cities, about ideals for the future. If the world asks beauty, asks connection, ask dignity, ask values, this world asks Italy. And for this reason, I think we must absolutely give more importance to the role of our country in a lot of dossiers. But I prefer listen your questions, and I go very quickly about the dossier open in my table as a prime minister in Italy. I simply some examples. Mediterranean dossier. The Mediterranean Sea exemplifies the connection between our roots and our future. It's the custodian of our memory, but also an harbor of innovation. We need to continue to work together, United States and the European Union, on making the Mediterranean safer and a place of civilization. Today, we risk a lot of things. We risk to lose the dignity of our value in Mediterranean. Because in this moment, after the decision of international community in Libya, in 2011, 2012, but without a strategy after this decision, every day a lot of men and women, a lot of children died in this sea to try to achieve the freedom. And this is an incredible spot, an incredible slogan for the people who believe in populism. Because there is, in Europe in this moment, you can believe in France, but you can believe also in part in Italy, a lot of parties, leaders, who said, the people of Africa must stay in Africa. We can close the sea. Close the sea. We can make laws very strong. But a people who died for the lack of food, for the war in Africa. Don't think about the law in France or in Italy. We can absolutely create Africa as a place of development for the next years. And we must ensure not only an ideal, a generical idea of freedom, of democracy in Libya and in the rest of North Africa, but a concrete opportunity to reduce the risk of terrorism and to change the approach about African questions. 90% of illegal migrants crossing the Mediterranean come from Libya. We want a united, peaceful Libya. We will discuss about it tomorrow with President Obama. We will continue our efforts in the correct direction. But let me be very clear. The stop human trafficking is a matter of security, clear, is also a matter of justice. And every day, Italian men and women, I'm proud of them, struggle to save human lives. I think these migrants are not number. They are faces, stories. There are people. And I think we can absolutely fight against the connection between the human trafficking and terrorists with obviously clear and evident. The Mediterranean, the European Union, but also the idea of Africa as a place in which energy, growth opportunities, and investment in the young generation and in young people is clear a possibility to reduce the risk of clash of civilization and invest in an idea of discussion. For this reason, there are a lot of Italian people, and there were a lot of Italian people in the 20th century who image Italy as the shape of Italy's boot as a bridge between different cultures. We must come back to the point of start of my speech. Culture is the only solution to fight against terrorism. But culture means simply not only a legacy in the cultural heritage, is a modality of a lifestyle, is an idea and of identity. So for this reason, and I conclude, the relation between Italy and the United States is not only a relation focused on the universities and the students, on American students who come in our continent and our country to spend some months, some years. Italian students who decide to live in abroad, to live abroad in the United States. Usually in Italy there is the traditional expression fuga di cervelli. When Italian young people decide to leave Italy and to spend the life or a part of life in a different country, the people said, "Oh, this is terrible. We are the people. We are the country of very importance of mother and father. And so, if a young girl and young boy decided to live abroad, there is a lot of polemics also in the politician debate. It's incredible. You permit the Italian mind live in the United States." I think this is a great thing. It's a great thing. The problem, I admire the success and energy of young Italians who innovate, create and improve the United States. At the same time, I'm very clear. When you spend the time here, we continue, we try, we will achieve a great result. We will change our country. We're changing our country. And when you come back, if you come back, also for for the holiday. But we will see if for holiday or for always, you will try a different country. A country in which we are absolutely convinced about the importance of past. And for this reason, let me be a special thanks to the United States in this moment, because this is a moment in which we remember 70 years of freedom of Italy from fascism and the Nazism occupation. And I'm very proud for the role of partigiani, the people who worked and who make war in Italy, but also special thanks to young American people who died for the freedom of a country very strange, because maybe some of these of those people doesn't know what is Italy. And I think this is a moment in which we must absolutely give the importance to this history, also about this history, but the ideals of democracy, freedom, tolerance, justice is absolutely important for us in the relation with the United States. So the real challenge today is a politics challenge. And I conclude with the expression of Robert Kennedy. Because I have spoken a lot about the past, it's hugely important to protect the yesterday, but we said remember and preserve only the past is not a job of politician, it's a job of museum curators, not of innovator. If you are a politician, you must offer a vision. A vision based on the knowledge in which the past is absolutely extraordinary, but this past is not sufficient. Our future will be better than past. This is the politics. And Bob Kennedy, a great American leader, said once, the future is not a gift, it's an achievement. I think in this moment, in a moment of change, our future is an achievement. Focused on the culture and of identity, but focused on the quality of a singular experience. So the politicians must realize reforms, must make very good laws, must fight against austerity and invest in a politics of growth. But at the same time, nobody could realize the future as an achievement without the courage and the empowerment of the single citizen who believe possible, create a particular challenge. Realize an Italy in which the future is more important than the past. It's not easy, but I'm sure it's amazing, it's fun, it's a great opportunity for everybody. Thank you. I'm a very Italian politician. I spoke
a lot. Right on time, right on time. Thank you so much, Prime Minister Renzi, for your forward-looking talk, for raising so many issues, and for also leaving time for a wider discussion with the audience here. I know there are lots of questions. We're going to have a microphone set up in the center aisle. People who have questions can start to line up, and I'd ask each questioner to briefly state their name, maybe their affiliation, and a short question. And while we're waiting for folks to take advantage of that opportunity, let me follow up on the general context of your visit to the United States. You're meeting with President Obama tomorrow, as I understand. Can you say something about how relations between the United States and Italy relate in turn to some of the themes of your talk, the importance of economic growth, the struggle against extremism, some of the context for your conversations tomorrow?
I think in this moment, American leadership is a great model for Europe in the economic, because American leadership with the presidency of Barack Obama in face to the great crisis, incredible crisis, the most terrible crisis after the Second World War, invest in the new dream, new American dream. Europe lost this opportunity, in my personal opinion. The model of economic development of Europe is a model focused on the austerity and not focused on the ideal of growth. The relation inside European context are not are good, are normal, are very, we are partner and ally, obviously, but we discussed a lot. Mm-hmm. And in every European Council, I repeat the same quote. I don't understand why American people, in those 7 years of crisis, invest in a future with growth, and Europe lost this opportunity. So for me, for my party, for my government, the relation about economics with the United States of America are stronger than the past. Barack Obama in the economics is absolutely a model for his vision. And I try with my Minister of Finance, who is today in Washington DC for IMF, with the other members of government to convince European people, European leadership to continue with the budget attention, it's clear, but with investment in the future. And the first results arrive from Jean-Claude Juncker, the new commission.
Thank you. Well, in the meantime, we have a long line of questioners, as far as the eye can see. And we've got about 20...
Sorry, tomorrow morning I have the meeting with the President Obama. So.
But let's see how quickly we can move through, please.
Buongiorno. Buongiorno, Presidente Renzi. Grazie di essere qui prima di tutto. My name is Costanza Concetti, and you've said that the future of Italy is more interesting than the past. And seeing that you have in front of you the Italian students who decided to come here to study in the hope that one day we will come back in the place of our values and our culture and seize the opportunities that our country has to offer us, then I want to ask you, what is your outlook on the specific opportunities that our countries will provide to us in terms of innovation, infrastructure, and energy?
Let me speak about this point in Italian, if you agree, because very, very brief speech. Io non vi dirò mai, come vi hanno detto in tanti, tornate, mi raccomando, c'è la fuga dei cervelli, sono preoccupato. Intanto è un'espressione stupida, la fuga del cervello, il pancreas, cos'è, è rimasto in Italia, non lo so. Ma il punto fondamentale è che è normale in un mondo globale poter vivere il proprio sogno anche lontano da casa. Quello che voglio dirvi è che io vi assicuro che noi faremo un paese in cui si va avanti non perché abbiamo gli amici degli amici, ma perché il merito conta. Si va avanti perché l'occasione di inseguire un sogno non è soltanto da questa parte dell'oceano, ma anche a casa propria. Se poi volete restare qui, perché vi sposate, vi fidanzate, perché state bene, perché vi piace più gli Stati Uniti, good luck. Ma se volete tornare indietro, troverete un paese che smette di essere ostaggio del potere di rendita dei soliti noti. Costi quel che costi, potrò perdere le prossime elezioni, ma non perderò la faccia davanti a voi. Questa è la mia promessa.
And now only in English, also because my terrible English.
Please. Good evening, Mr. President, and grazie di essere venuto qua con noi questa sera. Although we are pretty different for obvious reasons, and I'm an Italian student studying here, we have at least one thing in common. We both share this love for Giorgio La Pira. And In fact, it was my subject for my maturità, so it went well, so don't worry. And so I was wondering, once Lapira flew to Vietnam and talked to Ho Chi Minh and made him sign this peace, I wouldn't call it treaty because you need two people to sign a treaty, but it's this intent to make peace with the United States and then flew back here to Washington and presented to Johnson. My question is, what is your commitment, personal commitment as Matteo Renzi to help and figure out the Libyan solution right now? What is your position right now?
So the question is very difficult because Giorgio Lapira is also a saint. Was an incredible personality, and every time I worked for 5 years in the same office in which he worked, and every day was an emotion. I don't speak about the past and also the ideas very particular of Giorgio Lapira. You remember the first trip in the first and the last trip in Vietnam in the moment, very particular. Also the trip in Russia and the meeting of mayors in Florence, mayor of New York City and the mayor of Moscow at the same table in Palazzo Vecchio in Salone di Cinquecento. I give an answer also about Libya. I think in Libya the only way to make peace, to realize peace, is in the hands of the troops, of the people who live in Libya. It's impossible to realize peace in Libya without the ability to involve Libyan troops at the same table. Tribes. This is a big problem. Because when international community decide, and it was a correct decision, to remove Gaddafi, don't care about the next step. And now we have a country in which we risk every day continuation of civil war, but also for the pressure from the center of Africa in the South Libya, Libya could welcome a lot of immigrants from a part of African countries in conflict. So, first, we must support the try of Bernardino León, the special envoy of the United Nations. I asked to Ban Ki-moon the last September with more determination, please, Mr. Secretary, you must absolutely give a strong commitment to Bernardino León. For the moment, it's very difficult to imagine if there is a diplomatic solution. What we can and we need realize is Operation Counter-Terrorism, because the risk is the infiltration of ISIS, of Daesh, in Derna, in Sirte. There are two cities in the hands of Daesh. And continue with the control in the sea, because we must avoid in every way to trafficking human people, continue in a moment in which the way is very simple. You call a man, he pay $2,000, $2,500. $1,500 is the situation of the climate is not good. And the man who organized this incredible tragedy realized a business of $300,000, $400,000 every time, every night. This is foolish. but not, it's impossible for the international community bring the place of trips. We must force the Libyan to make the peace, because this is the only way also for them.
Please. The microphone doesn't seem to be working. Yeah, speak a little louder.
Okay. Hello, Mr. Renzi. I'm Furkan Pehlivanlı. I'm a student at School of Foreign Service. I'm from Turkey. I think that's the background information that's needed. I would like to thank you for your beautiful speech. And I would like to talk about a recent event. Recently, Pope Francisco, whom we also affiliated as a school, called Armenian events in 1915 as a genocide, which was approved by your fellow politicians. I would like to ask you the official stance of Italy on the Armenian events. Does Italy officially call these events as a genocide? And does Mr. Renzi, as the Prime Minister of Italy and as a citizen of Italy, call these events as a genocide or something else?
You know, the position of Italian government about it is clear. Minister of Foreign Affairs repeat the same position about after the reactions of Turkish government against the Pope. You know, the Pope criticized this, I think it's not correct expression. The Pope give a very clear message about what happened one century ago. The reaction of President Erdogan and my colleague Prime Minister was negative, and the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Paolo Gentiloni, made a statement of criticism against the position of a Turkish government about it. I think it's a goal for everybody, this for the situation of Armenian people one century after. I think Turkey is a great country. I think it's a value for everyone if Turkey realize the process of integration in European institutions. Turkey is a very important partner of NATO. But it's clear in this moment the process of integration of Turkey in European institutions depend on the government of Ankara. I spoke officially in Galle, in Waltz, in September during the NATO summit, supporting the position of Turkey for the entrance in European institutions, but today they must respect some values and some ideals with on the base of European community. I'm confident, and I hope the presidency of Turkey in the G20 this year could be a little step to stop with the polemics. The position are clear, and invest in the future, but at the same time respecting the common ideals and the common values.
Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Hello, my name is Agustin Porres. I'm from Argentina, studying public policy here at Georgetown. Thank you very much for...
In the University of Jesuit from Argentina. Fantastic. Your choose, future is very interesting.
I choose a great moment for this. Thank you very much for the lecture. It was amazing. I have a quick question. You say about the... You speak a lot about the future, about the culture. And you say something great, that is that politicians has to provide a vision to the citizens and to the country. What is your vision and the main three challenges for education policies in your country, in the European Union? What do we have to do with education systems during these days? What is the challenge for the new century?
Very briefly, first, Italy must change the model of organization of system of education for a problem of efficiency and of quality of organization. This is the first. I think it's not very interesting for you, but this is the first priority for us today in our country. If you think about the vision, point number two, I think I'm not in the same position of the majority of politicians and of stakeholders, because I think we must avoid the risk to invest in an education only technological and focused on scientists. Let me be very clear. I believe in the culture of traditional culture. I believe in the humanistic culture. I believe in an idea in which is absolutely important to ensure to the people the possibility to study the past, for example, not simply because we must create in the schools the skills, but because I think the school must create the citizens. So for this reason, my position, maybe is not a majority, is we must preserve the traditional and humanistic culture around the world. The school and education is not simply an instrument for technological career. The school and education is, first of all, a possibility to open the mind and the heart of the people. And if this means, but with not everybody could work with the history of arts, this is a risk, I know. But I prefer a man who cry in front of Leonardo's masterpiece. I have people who know very well everything of mathematics, but he lost the emotion and the ideals. This is my vision, maybe it's not the majority.
Buongiorno, signor Presidente. My name is Daniele. I work here in the US. Thank you for being here, and thank you for your forward-looking remark. We shall indeed look at the future. However, from the outside, the future for Italy doesn't seem too bright, despite all the good things you mentioned, and despite the extremely favorable macroeconomic situation that we enjoy right now. Projections from the IMF and from your own government for Italy in the next couple of years, both in terms of unemployment and GDP growth that you mentioned, are among the worst in the whole European community. So I guess my question is, what gives you confidence that what you are doing is working and will work?
I offer you the vision of the last 3 years. 2012, Mario Monti's government, GDP Italy, minus 2.3%. 2013, Enrico Letta government, minus 1.9. I look, there is the members of cabinet, yes. because it's very important fact-checking in politicians. 2014, 0.4 with my government. So 3 years of crisis with a little improve, but the problem is the combination between the lack of reforms and the politics of austerity. For the future, the provision are finally, after 3 years, we come back to plus. Not sufficient for me, but it's a first step. Plus 0.7 for our provision, 0.5 for IMF, 0.91, I think is not important, the important is finally we come back to positive growth. Why I'm confident? Because we change the labor market, and we give a message very important to foreign investors, but also for Italian people. Because we reduce the power of red tape of bureaucracy, and you know, you are Italian, you know very well the terrible power of bureaucracy in our country. I think at the same time, we must absolutely give a message of positive approach, not because this is a psychological message. It's, I don't know the translation of gruppo di autoaiuto in English. Self-aid, you know, the telefilm, the TV series in which everybody thanks for sharing, everybody share the air problem. So the message of optimistic is a message for the mind. No, I think it's economic message. And I give you a little example. 2012, you remember, minus 2.3, the level of savings in Italy are €3.5 trillion. Now it's a similar, but 3.5 euros. It's a good, very important, good thing for us, the new relation between euro and dollar. 2012, 3.5. 2014, 3.9. So in a moment of crisis, you can think the savings are at the level of decreasing. No. In Italy, the savings, the private savings, are grew up 10%. Why? Because we lost the confidence. This is a real problem. I don't speak about the relation between public debt, very high in Italy, 2 trillion, and private saving. The most important private saving around the world, as average in respect of the pro capita. This is absolutely interesting for the discussion with the markets, but you know, we can use this expression for the markets because the savings are not important in the statistics. What's important for me, it's if in 2012, 2014, the savings grow up, this means there is a problem of confidence in Italy. So I must realize reforms, Jobs Act and the labor market, fiscal system, public administration, electoral law, constitutional reforms, education system. But if we don't come back to level of confidence positive in Italy, the problem remains the same. I believe this is the real challenge in the Italian politics. In a side, there is some parties who believe the future of Italy is terrible. They bet on the crisis. And in the other side, there are a part of politicians who believe possible comeback to positive growth. So, but France, Germany, in this moment, are provision more positive. I'm happy for France and Germany. I know in the next years, if Italy make the reforms, Italy will be the leader of Europe for the next 20 years. This is not for applause, this is a reality. This is a reality. If we realize the reform, our pension system is absolutely good, respect our colleagues and partners of Europe. Our quality of engineering is extraordinary. Our manufacturing and the second in Europe and one of the most important around the world. When Jeff Immelt, one example, the leader of GE, visited me last year, he told me, oh, I'm very, very excited about some character of Italy, and I believe. Culture, masterpieces, food, lifestyle, holidays. His answer, not engineering. The level of your quality, of your engineering, is the best around the world. So I'm confident, despite the provision, because I think if Italy realizes reforms, Italy finally decide to invest in the future, maybe Italy not only come back in the role of leadership, but is also an hope for the rest of Europe.
So we've come up against our official time limit, and maybe that's a good point on which to end. It's too bad we have a long line of questioners. You can see the interest in your visit here to Georgetown. Would you like to take another question or two? It's up to you.
One question, okay.
One more, please.
The real role of president of council is not very powerful. Every schedule, every meeting not depend of you. You are simply an actor in the hands of terrible men and women called the protocollo. Are very dangerous. They are very dangerous people.
Okay, grazie final mille, question. Protocollo. Buonasera, Presidente Renzi. Many thanks to the University of Georgetown for hosting, and grazie, sono tutto qua. Mio nome è Ivan Butina. Io lavoro come. My name is Ivan Butina. I work as a community builder at the World Bank Group. When I was 8 years old, I was born in Bosnia. When I was 8 years old, because of the war in my country of origin, I moved to Italy. Later, I became Italian citizen. And now, as an Italian citizen, I've been living in the Washington, D.C. for 7 years. So now I'm an Italian expat. So I want to make a point based on...
Could you ask a question?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm going to make a point based on what you said at the end, which is you invite us Italians abroad, expats, saying that when we come back, we will find a country that has changed, right? So I would like to make a proposal and to actually involve us in the change process of the country. Because as you say, we're not fuga dei cervelli, but we are actually cervelli da valorizzare. We are here and many of us are willing to help. So maybe the government of Italy could either launch or support an initiative to connect all the Italians abroad who want to help Italy, you know, to help promote investments, commerce, tourism, culture, to help transfer our knowledge, know-how for Italian institutions, private sector, civil society, and so to realize our potential, because many of us do want to be part of the chain, not just come when everything is done by you and who is in Italy.
Thank you.
So one thing also, tonight we have a 6:30 professional networking event with Italians in DC, and we have companies like Autogrill, Beretta, and Lamborghini. If you want to stop by just to say hi, it's here in Georgetown.
Okay.
And by
okay.
the way, everyone is invited.
Thank you so much for invitation, but in the team of Protocollo, there is also the ambassador organized a dinner in official residency called Villa Firenze. I'm very proud for that, but Villa Firenze come from Florence, not from the city, from the woman, Florence. So, about your consideration, I think this could be a great propose to continue in this involving the people. But let me conclude exactly from the point from which I started. This link could happen, could be realized only if we have a common ideal and value, not only the same passport. In other words, obviously, we are very happy, the Italian people who believe in our country, for me, it's a reason of happiness, of responsibility, and thank you so much for this disponibility. But I think in this moment, to be Italian around the world means remember to everybody, to you, first of all, and to everybody, what is Italian value around the world? So, if you speak about Lamborghini, it's important to remember to Lamborghini's team the investment in Bologna with 500 people to new jobs will realize next year, I hope. But it's not the most important thing. The most important thing is remember to ourselves, if we are Italians, we are not simply a catalog of genius of the past. We are the people who have in DNA the possibility to believe in the future and not only in the past. For this reason, I think the contribution from you, from abroad, is obviously the link, the connection, the teamworking, the ideals and ideas to share with us, but it's above all the idea we can build a different world focused not only in the economic values, but focused on the quality of cultural values. Let me be very frank. I know there are not a difference and are not a division between economic values and cultural values. If you think, for example, exactly my city, Florence, you know the financial system create masterpieces of art. The people here who know the history of Florence knows very well the incredible history of genius, innovation, affrescos, paintings, buildings, architecture come from a new era of finance. The financial system invests in the culture, invests in the innovation. So there is a link between economic development and mind development. But in this world, the globalization give a message in which the important is only the money and the value. I think we must absolutely work hard, work strongly, achieve the results and achieve the great results in the personal career. But to be Italian means remember ourselves, there are the values of emotion and of ideals with the value eternal and perpetual. This for me means to be Italian around the world, and my request is exactly that. Help us to remember ourselves. To be Italian means to be people who try every day to build a different idea of future, remembering the past but challenging on tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So we, unfortunately, we do have to draw our conversation to a close. You do have a very busy schedule. I hope you get a sense of the enthusiasm here at Georgetown among our students and faculty and staff, enthusiasm for Italy and for your forward-looking message. We hope you'll come back to join us again soon. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me again in thanking Prime Minister Renzi.